takes my thoughts and makes them better. So I'm teasing, a total joke. You didn't know if I was serious or not. He's a good friend. So if he has a good thought, I'll be glad to preach it. He'll be glad to preach one of mine too. So it's all good. But he is going to be here that Sunday preaching both services. And let's see, I want to take 5 to 7 minutes and talk about the ministry of small groups as a way of inspiring your thought process and inspiring your sense of can do, your sense of potential. And I was thinking this week about how small group ministry requires us to change our mindset just a little bit. If we have spent most of our life in a church structure where that structure kind of has a predetermined style and order, there is a habit we fall into of being somewhat passive. And although we support the order such as it is, we support the services, we support the ministries, we do not necessarily feel any sense of doing anything ourselves. We support what is already going. That is quite common, particularly if the church does have ministries, the church does have efforts and the like. We kind of passively support whatever is scheduled. And so once we decide, well, one of the best ways I could influence friends, I could make friends, I could meet people, I could meet people in the church, out of the church, once we buy into this idea that hosting a small group or supporting a small group, because we need both, is a path forward for me to minister in my society. A lot of times we kind of have this big structure view, or if you'll allow me to say it this way, the difference of working for a big corporation versus starting a business. If you work for a big corporation, what you expect is you expect the corporation to decide what you do, where you do, and who you do it for. And so you're like, well, sure, if the corporation will give me a room, send people to me, give me a subject, I'll be glad to teach. But that is not how small groups work. Small groups is much more entrepreneurially based. It's thinking more like an entrepreneur. It's thinking more like starting a ministry rather than supporting a ministry. And so what you begin to do once you buy into that, you begin to think, what could I do that would include others, whereby I could extend my relationships, whereby I could make friends of people that are in the church perhaps and looking for those relationships, and whereby I could have a venue, a vineyard in which to work, a venue in which to minister, a place in which to show the love of God to people. And so starting a small group is the opposite of having a kind of a big company mentality where, you know, the pastor decides, Brother Jeremy is going to teach on real estate development, and I'm going to give him a classroom at 7 o'clock on Tuesday nights. And Brother Jeremy is going to teach on that subject because he's well educated on the subject, and he's going to be there. And he's like, okay, whatever, I'll do whatever. And he shows up, and then whoever comes. That's kind of having this big company mindset, not an entrepreneurial mindset. Entrepreneurial mindset is much more inclined to, what could I host that would include my neighbors, include friends, include people in the church that I could get to know better? What could I host, or what service could I offer whereby I could get to know people? And it puts the point of decision and the locus of control in your hand, and you're not looking for the corporation to tell you what, when, where, and who. You have to be innovative. You have to be creative. You have to try things. That means you occasionally fail. It's worth it. You have to put yourself out there. You have to show yourself friendly. You have to, oh heaven help us, meet your neighbors. You have to host your coworkers. You have to show forth love. And if your friends, your neighbors, your coworkers, the people in your neighborhood, people that you know, if they get the sense that, man, that guy really would like to be my friend, I'm telling you, you're doing it right. If they get the sense that, man, why would they keep inviting me to something? I want to tell you, you're doing it right. Because that sense of creativity, that sense of innovation, that is how you find a small group subject that fits you, fits the people in your life, and presents tremendous opportunity for you to, as it were, develop a vineyard of people that you can show the love of God to. Does that make sense? So if you're waiting for me to give you a subject, it's going to be a long wait. I may eventually do it because I'm just frustrated. You are doing a small group on running every morning at 6 a.m. Oh, save me, Lord. Save me, Lord. So we are continuing our Bible study on justice, and we are looking at a passage of Scripture here. We're going to read in Matthew chapter number 12, and we will read verse number 34. Last Wednesday night, we talked about the issue of how the tongue is full of hellfire. Literally, the Bible says that. And we're going to continue that. Let's stand together since it is our regular order. We'll read at Matthew 12 and verse number 34. This is Jesus speaking. Brood of vipers, how can you, being evil, somebody say being evil. How can you, being evil, speak good things? How can you, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Somebody say, oh, help me, Lord Jesus. You may be seated. So a review from last week. Well, before I get into that, I want to tell you a joke, okay? This is a joke about gossip. There was a man who has recently joined a church. And he had grown up in the church, and he knew how some of these churches worked. And so he had been gone for some years. He came back into the church, and he knew there was a lady in the church who she was the busybody, the designated busybody of the church, bless her holy name. And she knew everybody's business, and let's call her Mildred. If anybody here is named Mildred, Mildred, I apologize. We're going to just call her Mildred. Mildred loved to kind of be the moral police of the church, and she was prone to get in everybody's business. And he had just gotten to church. He had kind of figured out how the church was. It was not dissimilar to the way he had grown up. He knew how to deal with it. And his truck broke down, and but as he was coasting and it was going slower down the road, the only place for him to pull off on the road was the parking lot of a bar. And so at the last momentum, he turned into the bar and he parked his truck. And he thought to himself, oh my Lord, I hope nobody in the church sees me parked at that bar. But unlucky for him, Sister Mildred was on the case. And she drove by and she saw his truck parked in that bar. And she called up several people in the church, and she said, oh, we need to pray for our new brother. I am afraid he's an alcoholic. I am afraid he is a partier, and although he is in our church, I am afraid that he is out carousing. The Lord allowed me to see that he was at the bar all night long. So this went around the church real fast, and because you know that's the nature of humanity. And the following Sunday, when this new member came to the church, he had several people come up to him and let him know that they were praying for him. They knew he was fighting alcoholism. He didn't know he was fighting alcoholism, but he found out he was fighting alcoholism. And several people said, "Brother, I want you to know I'm praying for you. I know it can be a very difficult battle for you to fight alcoholism, but the Lord will see you through." Well, at first he was offended, but then he got a little bit tickled. He said, "How can I use this to my advantage?" So that Sunday night, he went and parked his truck all night long in front of Sister Mildred's house. We read James 3 and 5 last week. Even so, the tongue is a little member and boasteth great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindleth. And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body and setteth on fire. Somebody say fire. Setteth on fire the course of nature, and it is set on fire of hell. That word hell is not Hades, but Gehenna, which refers to prophetically the final lake of fire. Basically, James saying, if you're not careful, your tongue will be an agent of hell. If you're not careful, your tongue will have more in common with the fire of hell than it has with anything else. We also read from Proverbs 26 and 20, where no wood is, there the fire goes out. Where there's no talebearer, the strife ceaseth. The Lord tells us scripturally, if you were not here last week for the Bible study, please take advantage of the podcast, that everything is available for your listening pleasure. In fact, I would like to mention, since I'm thinking about it, ways that you can support the church in a social media sense. One of the things you can do is check in when you're here in the services. If you check in, it shows every one of your friends that you came to church, and that becomes a testimony of a sort. And believe it or not, it really bumps the church up in that kind of a thing. Another thing you can do is leave a review on the podcast. That has a huge effect in bringing the podcast up in the search results. So if I ever say anything good, I know it's rare, but if I did and you wanted to give me a compliment, something you could do is go to the message where I got lucky and said something good and leave that comment as a review, and pretty soon, hey, I'll be a rock star. Oh, yeah. Not really, but this is a way that we can, you know, can use these tools forward. So where there is no talebearer, the strife ceaseth. God tells us not to associate with talebearers. It tells us not to hang out with them, not to run with them. Not one place in the Bible are we told to help a talebearer. We're told to help the drunkard. We're told to help the adulterer, the thief, the liar, the crook. But nowhere can you see anywhere where we're told to help the talebearer. The Proverbs 25:23 we read, the north wind driveth away rain, so doth an angry countenance a backbiting tongue. When you know someone is speaking wrong, unfairly of someone else, the Bible says one of the ways you can shut them up is let them know you're not happy about it. Don't pick fights. We have plenty of that going on. But you get the idea. You don't have to accept a negative report. So tonight, I want to continue this idea, dealing with the tongue. But I want to explain to you, and if the Lord will help me, I want to share with you the difference between evil and sin. There is a difference between evil and sin. So before we go on, I want you to acknowledge this within your own heart. We are all of us a sinner, saved by grace, saved by the work of the Lord Jesus Christ, changed by his Spirit toward a nature that inclines us toward the things of God. But there is a difference between sin and evil, and I want to explain that here today. A sin comes from a Greek word that literally means to miss the mark. This is why the Bible's so strong about the truth that all have sinned. Paul is quite adamant about it. In fact, Paul is even willing to have a theological argument over it in the strident manner in which he says it. And he's not the only one. John is absolutely strident in this point that we all have sinned. And John even goes further and is more pugnacious about it than Paul when he says, look, if you say you don't have sin, you're a liar and the truth is not in you. What is sin is to miss the mark. That is when you knew to do, when you knew what would be right, but you missed the mark. Evil, however, is a different word and it has a different meaning. And once you understand this difference, it will bring a certain insight as you read the New Testament and you see sin spoken of and you see evil spoken of. This is quite an illumination to the observant reader to see the distinction in the scripture, in the passages, in the writing, in the epistles, between this concept of sin versus a concept of evil. Remember, sin was to miss the mark, not to make it, not here's the goal, I didn't get there. This is the standard, I did not make it. That's sin. Evil is to actually cause harm to someone. Evil is not just sin. Evil is to injure, comes literally from a word that means to injure. Remember the Lord's Prayer, deliver us from evil. This difference is not a small thing. It is a quite large thing. We read Matthew 12 and verse 34 about this generation of vipers and brood of vipers. How can you, being evil, speak good things? Jesus is not calling them sinners, although they are sinners. Evil is always sin, but sin is not always evil. I'm going to say that again for you melancholy souls. Evil is always sin, but sin is not always evil. And when the Lord calls the Pharisees evil, he is saying something that is not about the state of sin within them. He's saying something about the intent of their hearts. And he calls them a brood of vipers because of the evil that is within them. I'm going to try to talk about this a little bit more. I don't know if I'll do it justice, but there is so much here that if you've ever asked the question, and I know many of you have, I've talked with many of you, why did Jesus choose the Pharisees as his ideological enemies? Why did he choose the Pharisees as his philosophical enemies? Why did he choose the Pharisees as his religious enemies? You have to understand this difference between sin and evil, or you will not understand the difference. Because if you see it all as sin, stay with me. If you see it all as sin, you will say, Jesus, why are you embracing and forgiving of a harlot when you are so judgmental and angry at a Pharisee? They're both just sinners, right? You see the problem? Why are you so willing to forgive, and not just forgive, but to protect? Let him without sin cast the first stone. Why are you so willing to forgive and protect this kind of sin, but this sinner over here, is mercy just for the shameful sinner? Isn't there mercy for the righteous sinner? Oxymoron, but you get the idea. Is mercy just for the person who's embarrassed the family and the church and the temple? Isn't there mercy for the person who gets a little lifted up in pride? Jesus, why are you so protective and forgiving of this kind of sin, and you are driven to temper expressions, brood of vipers, by this kind of sin? You need to understand the difference in sin and evil. So let's move along here. Sin is a mistake by an individual. Sin is a flaw or a fault by an individual. Sin can even be a bad decision by an individual. If you did something today and you know, and anybody who finds out, no, you shouldn't have done it, you have sinned. That is to be a sinner. That is to miss the mark, literally, to miss the mark, to not be the person that you could be through God, to not be the individual of faith, the worker and the warrior for the kingdom of God you could have been. You missed the mark. You are a sinner. You should have spoke faith. Instead, you spoke doubt. Sin. All of these things are sin. However, evil is to be allied with a system of injury, pain, or destruction to other people. Do you see? Sin is when I fail. Evil is when I hurt, I offend, I exclude. Do you see the difference? This, more than anything else, will help you understand the difference between Jesus' embrace, protection, and love for the sinner who knew they were a sinner, and his outrage at the Pharisee who, with all their pretense, used their excellence, their piety, their devotion as a mean to exclude, as a means to judge, as a means to limit access to God. So Jesus says in John chapter number 8, and we've got a long way to go here, so let me move along quickly. John 8 and 44, ye are of your father the devil, and the lusts of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in truth, because there is no truth in him. Let me ask you a question. Who did Lucifer kill? You were a murderer from the beginning. Let's not rush past the text. Who did Lucifer kill? You were a murderer from the beginning. Who did he kill? The heavenly host? Can he kill the heavenly host? Who can Lucifer kill? The murder that is being talked about is to be, I believe, and I would teach, understood in the sense of murder that Jesus spoke of on the Sermon on the Mount. When you have hatred in your heart, it is as though you have already committed murder. The high standard of God's righteousness and God's challenge and that aspirational goal for us to live toward and incline ourselves toward. Lucifer's problem wasn't just sin. It was his willingness to injure others. Lucifer did not just get lifted up in pride. He led the host of heaven in rebellion. It wasn't just sin. It was evil. People that become a part of a system, and I'm using this word system broadly, and I know this is a fairly heavy subject, and I'm sorry if I've got you discouraged and depressed already. I tried to tell you a funny joke at the beginning to lift your spirits, but now I see you're beset with weariness and weight. People that become a part of a system that injures other people, that excludes other people, that hurts other people, that defames other people, that attacks other people's reputation, that makes other people dislike people they haven't even met yet because of what you said, you are not sinning, you are working evil. That is a much greater transgression than sin. Do you see? This is where Jesus could say, truthfully, it would be better for you to tie a millstone around your neck and be cast in the sea than to offend a little one. He's talking about the difference in sin and in evil. Listen to me. When you go out and you get drunk, that's a sin. When you drive drunk and kill somebody, that's evil. You see the difference? When you tell a lie, that's a sin. When you tell a lie about somebody, that's evil. When you tell the truth about somebody that's none of your business and you hurt them, you injure them, and you leave the people you're talking to feeling worse, bad, or angry in their spirit against them without cause, you are working the work of evil. Sin becomes evil when you become a helper of Lucifer by doing Lucifer's job for him and hurting other people. He is the accuser of the brethren because it's not just enough for him to be in rebellion. He wants to hurt you. He wants to injure you. He was a murderer from the beginning. Do you see the difference in sin and evil? 2 Timothy 3, chapter number 13. But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. This is the understanding that the evil here is not simply sinners who might have spent the weekend on 7 different types of drugs, might have embarrassed themselves with their decisions, might have made a mess of things. Those are sinners. These are people who would deceive and they would seduce, not for the point of their own lusts, but for the point of injuring others in some way. Sin is what you do that destroys you. Evil is what you do that destroys others. You guys with me? And 99% of the time, it's something we do with what we say. 99% of the time, the way we hurt other people and the way we enter into evil is by what we say. Remember a few Bible studies ago, I talked about speaking evil, the difference between judging and speaking evil. We talked about that. I don't want to get back into it because I still have a long way to go here. Sin is when I have aught in my heart against my brother without cause. Evil is when I go tell the whole church about the aught I have in my heart against my brother. And so let me read you a story that's in the scripture, and this story is in Nehemiah. It's a great story that I have preached from many times, and you have heard it from others preached from many times. It's the story of the rebuilding of Jerusalem. And I will start reading at verse number 12. This is Nehemiah telling his story. Now, what has happened is there is a quote-unquote prophet. I say that because he has been hired to use his label to help Sanballat and Tobiah. Who is Sanballat and Tobiah? They are individuals who do not want the walls of Jerusalem to be rebuilt. They like the fact that the Israelites have all been excluded, and they want the lands for themselves and their people. And so they are actively working to stop the rebuilding of the walls, the rehanging of the gates, and the like. And so we read in chapter number 6 and verse number 12, "Then I, Nehemiah, perceived that God had not sent him at all." Now he's talking about this this so-called prophet. He's not sent of God at all. "I perceived that God had not sent him at all, but that he pronounced this prophecy against me because of Tobiah, because Tobiah and Sanballat had hired him. For this reason he was hired, that I should be afraid and act that way and sin." Okay, what is he saying? This prophet comes to Nehemiah and he says, "Sanballat and Tobiah want to kill you. They're going to try to assassinate you. We need to get you in the safest place we can. If you do not seek the safest place, you are going to be killed." Where's the safest place? Well, the first level of security they would have would be the incomplete walls that are around Jerusalem. Walls is where a city defends itself. That's where you position your defense teams and army and the like. But that is incomplete. There's ways in and out. So the prophet comes to Nehemiah and says, "You should go in the temple," because the temple has another level of guards. It has the temple guards. "You should not stay just in the city. You should come in the temple." Well, no one could go in the temple except in the worship of the Lord according to the order of the Levites. And if Nehemiah would have believed this report, he would have gone in the temple. He's not supposed to go in there. He would have, as it were, defiled it out of the order of worship. And the Bible says, if he would have done that, they would have had cause for an evil report that they might reproach me. "For this reason he was hired, that I should be afraid and act that way and sin." I'm sinning, "so that they might have cause for an evil report that they might reproach me." If Nehemiah goes into the place that is prescribed against him, he's not allowed to go. If he desecrates it, that's a sin. When Sanballat and Tobiah go around and say, "This leader you've got's not much of a leader. He doesn't even respect the temple you guys are trying to rebuild." That's an evil report. One is the sin of fear, the sin of bad judgment, the sin of believing a false report, or perhaps valuing yourself more than the sacred things of God and being unwilling to risk your life before you would transgress the sacred commandments of the Lord. That's all sin. But the moment Sanballat and Tobiah take the report and then run off and say, "You're not going to know, you can't believe, you're not going to believe what has happened, this so-called leader, he doesn't even respect the temple," that is an evil report. It's evil because they are in an alliance. They have this system in place whereby they can damage the people of God. They have used every method they could find to discourage the building of the wall. And when people agree in any organizational sense to come up with a system to hurt somebody, to damage their good name, to thwart their purpose, to in some way injure them, it is not sin, it is, somebody say it with me, evil. And so this evil report is what they are going to share because they have a scheme, they have this plan, they have this evil, let's just say plan. I couldn't come up with another word. To destroy, to hurt, to kill, and to injure. Let me give you another story from the word of the Lord. This is the story of Jacob, and it is told to us, Jacob and Joseph. It is told to us in the book of Genesis, chapter number 37. And we will read in verse number 1. "Now Jacob dwelt in the land where his father was a stranger, in the land of Canaan. This is the history of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brothers. And the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought back a bad report of them to his father. This is the story where you begin to see the tension that Joseph has with his brothers, okay? So now we drop down to verse number 17 and 19, 17 through 19. And the man said, they have departed from here, and I heard them say, let us go to Dothan. Now what's happening? Joseph is going after his brothers, and he finds them in Dothan. Now when they, his brothers, saw him afar off, even before he came near them, they conspired against him to kill him, when they said one to another, look, this dreamer is coming. Come, therefore, let us now kill him and cast him into some pit, and we shall say, some wild beast has devoured him, and we shall see what shall become of his dreams. What is happening? There is tension between the brethren. They dislike this brother who is favored of his father. If all they have in their heart is jealousy, that's sin. Do you see? If all they have in their heart is, man, I'd like to smack some sense into that little punk, that's sin. If all they have in their heart is, I wish he'd stub his toe, fall down the stairs, and break his pinky, that's sin. But evil is once you enter into a system, a plan, a scheme, a conspiracy, that's the word I was looking for a moment ago, to harm somebody, you can't say you're a sinner. You are now a worker of iniquity. You can't say you're a sinner. You now are working evil. You cannot say you just got carnal. Now you are in league with hell. Because you are not simply in error. You are doing what the Pharisees did. You are seeking to hurt. And just as the Pharisees can use the pretense of God to hurt, to exclude, and to wound, religious people from all generations can err in the same way, to use an outward perception of religion to hurt, to err, and to wound. You can have a conspiracy to injure somebody, just like the Jews formed an alliance to hurt Paul and others who were preaching the Gospels to the Gentiles and bring an attack against them. They can decide to bring harm. Now, I can very quickly give you a manner in which you will have very little attack in your life. If you don't really try to do anything for the kingdom of God, you won't have much attack in your life. As long as you'll stay in Babylon and just take care of the things there, a Sanballat and Tobiah will never come against you. As long as you just stay quiet and don't develop your ministry opportunities, you won't have many Sanballats and Tobiahs in your life. There won't be many attacks that come against you. But the moment you try to step out of your comfort zone and do something for God, there's going to be somebody who wants to cut you back down to size. The moment a church starts having a breakthrough in a community, there are plenty of people who want to criticize it. The moment a church starts having testimony reports, in fact, I know a lot of preachers that have good things happen and they don't even put it out there because they don't want to be criticized. And so they don't even go on social media and say, we had 6 get the Holy Ghost. They don't even do it because they don't want to be criticized. This is a sure way in which to get criticized by others, and that is to try something, to attempt something, to develop your ministry, to step out on faith, to love people, to take chances, to speak out, to pray, to do something. Guess what? Sanballat and Tobiah don't want to let you have any spiritual progress or any spiritual momentum, and they will conspire to bring you back down to size, to let you know that you're not special. Do you see what happens? And so it is the nature of the human heart for us to compare ourselves one with another. And when we see somebody who's getting a little uppity, for us to cut them back down to size. Now you can deny it, but you know and I know that's the nature of the human heart. We cannot be in the business, my brothers and sisters, of using this little member that is in, you know, the little red devil between the pearly gates. We cannot be in the business of using the hellfire of the tongue to become workers of evil by seeking to hurt anybody else in any way, by seeking to cast blame on anybody else in any way. We do not want to work evil. Yes, I'm a sinner. Now, I'm not proud of that fact, but I will tell you I miss the mark many times. I know that makes you a little nervous for me to say that, because you thought for some years now that I was perfect. And I want you to know I thought for many years I was perfect too. And then reality set in. But I don't want to be a worker of evil. I don't want to be in the business of harming anybody. I don't want to be in the business of talking bad about anybody trying anything. I am trying to purge myself with sincere weeding the garden of my heart. I am trying to purge myself of having to cast judgment on what other ministers are trying to do. By having to speak bad about disagreements I have theoretically with other ministries or other churches. We can't get into this business of trying. Oh, it's quiet now. My Lord. You know, if the Lord blesses any church with a great revival, it comes with an attack of the devil. In my personal life, if the moment you really take some chances, that's when the trouble comes. That's when the misunderstanding comes. That's when the nervousness sets in. And that's where other people, perhaps not even knowing it, end up speaking evil about you, because they don't want you to think you're getting up a little too high in yourself. We don't want to be that kind of church. Can I have a big amen? James 3 and 8, but the tongue no man can tame. It is an unruly evil full of deadly poison. Now, I didn't say that. That's what the Bible said. James said that, and he seems to have quite understanding as he says it. The Bible does not call the tongue evil. The Bible calls it full of a deadly poison. It's an unruly evil, the Bible says it. In other words, full of poison. In other words, foul language is a sin. If you have a young child and they start learning bad words at school, and they come home and matter-of-factly blurt them out, I want you to know you can put a very serious expression on your face, but sometimes you're laughing so hard inside that you don't know that they can tell. And I would tell some stories about that, and you would love them very much, and you would laugh very hard, but they're young ears here, and we will not do it. Thank you very much. God bless you all. I can tell you're disappointed. You wanted to hear those stories. Bad language is a sin. Talking bad about people is evil. When we enter into a conspiracy to hurt others by our tongue, we are using it for what it was not created for, which was glorifying God, speaking good, whatever things are good, pure, et cetera, et cetera. We're using it for what the devil made of it. And so I don't want to be the kind of person that needs to rise up and judge someone, needs to comment on them, needs to in some way join a conspiracy to hurt them. As you know, different ministries have different personalities, and all of us have that reality in our life. There's going to be people in my life that I naturally get along with a little bit better than others. You guys understand? You don't need any tongues interpretation to understand that. There's going to be certain people you get along with better than others, okay? That's just the way it is. That's something we should not spend a lot of time allowing ourselves to agonize over. There's someone in the church that you don't click with. It's okay. They get to go to heaven too. And if there's someone in the church who doesn't like you very much, good news and bad news. The good news is that's okay. The bad news is they get to go to heaven too, right? I don't know if God's going to change them to be more like you in heaven, or I don't know if God's going to change you to accept people who aren't like you. I don't know. We'll figure it out better by and by. But that's the truth of the matter. When do we cross over from having preferences in our personality, having people that we like more than others, and I'm almost done, into evil? I would say it most often happens when we experience some type of jealousy or unwise comparison one to another in our heart. Jealousy is the door to evil. If you're jealous of somebody, if they have something you wish you had, if they have some ability you wish you had, if they have some talent you wish you had, if they had some position you wish you had, jealousy will open the door to evil. Because while you may feel in your heart dislike for them, that sin. But then when you go out with your three friends to lunch and you say, I just don't, who can I pick on tonight? I'm already picking on Jeremy. I don't know who Jeremy thinks he is. Have you seen him rush around this church? He thinks he's taken over everything. He just rushes around this. He'd take over from Brother Nathan if he could. Well, that's kind of the truth, but you know, I'm just kidding. I hope your mother-in-law's not watching that. She probably is, isn't she? She's saying, hey, sister, God bless you. It's almost done. You see, I may not get along with Jeremy since I'm picking on him, or I pick on Zach. I may not get along with Zach. But the moment I try to influence my friends not to like Zach too, I'm not just a sinner. I'm speaking evil. I may not like, let me just make this real. I may not like a neighboring church. I'm fine with all of our neighboring churches. I mind my business. They mind their business. So let's just make this real for everybody, okay? I may not like the way a neighboring church runs things. I may not like the way they paint their church bus. I don't know how any of them paint that, but you get the idea. I mean, it's fine for me not to like it. But the moment I sit down with my three pastor friends and I say, you know, so-and-so's an idiot, that's speaking evil. And the same manner you have to repent, I have to repent. You see what I'm saying? Because it's one thing to sin, but it's something else to be an ally of hell and an instrument of Lucifer, and not to use my tongue for what it was made for, which is to glorify God, but to use it in a conspiracy to hurt, to wound, to cast doubt, suspicion on somebody else. I'm so glad we don't have anybody here in the church like that. Let's all stand. Romans 12 and 21. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. So let me settle this once and for all. Just because someone has done evil to you, you do not get to do evil back to them. You have to take it. Why do you have to take it? Because that's the way of the cross. Why do you have to turn the other cheek? Because that's the way of the cross. And when you hear someone has talked bad about you, you don't get to talk bad about them. Turn the other cheek. Let God fight your battles. We overcome evil with good. Lord Jesus, I thank you for your people. I thank you for the sincere zeal with which they serve you. I thank you for the time they take out of their lives to honor you. I thank you for the praise that's in their heart. And when we come together, praise flows out of our heart toward you. Lord Jesus, help us apply your word in a very real and living way in our hearts, oh God, that we can be stronger, because we know if we lift you up, you will draw all men unto you. We know that if we exalt your way, if we exalt the Christian way, if we carry the cross you have given us in a way that gives you glory, if we lift you up, you will draw all men to you. I thank you, Lord Jesus. I praise you for it today. I worship you in your holy saving name. Would you clap your hands and praise to the Lord one more time before we're dismissed?
Thank you for watching First Church Charlotte. If you're in the Charlotte, North Carolina area, come join us at 4929 North Sharon Amity Road at the corner of Shamrock Drive, Sunday mornings at 9 and 11 a.m., and Bible study Wednesdays at 7:30 p.m. Online, find us at firstchurchclt.com or like us on Facebook or Twitter. We hope to see you soon. Come worship with us.